Joining us from Hollywood, California via Skype is Fred Stoller. He is the star of The Mild Adventures of Fred Stoller, which you can download on iTunes. I highly recommend it. He's also a highly acclaimed author with two books out. One is My Seinfeld Year. That's a best-selling Kindle single, and I mean a best-selling Kindle single. His other book is Maybe We'll Have You Back, and that's going to be out in paperback in September. Cannot recommend those two books enough. Welcome, Fred Stoller.
Excuse me. Thank you. I thought you said he claims to be a writer, but I'm acclaimed.
You are. So. You're a great writer, a great stand-up, a great character actor, and a horrible human being.
Right, right. I'm trying to get to be better as something, but thank you, yes.
And you're an old friend of this show. You go back to our earliest episodes when we were just fiddling around doing improv. I remember I had a fictitious son who was in a coma, and I sent you over to hold his hand and do an impression of me because
fictitious. I really did go to a hospital and hold a kid's hand. He wasn't really a son.
We were doing, this was 6 years ago, we were doing improv, and I remember we did the thing where it was pilot season and my son was in a coma, a diabetic coma, and I couldn't go visit him at Cedars-Sinai, so I sent you to go visit him to do an impersonation of me.
Right, because he didn't know.
He wouldn't know the difference. This way I could go out and read during
the pilot season. Sure.
Freddie Stoller, you have a mother named Pearl and a father named Morris, Pearl and Morris Stoller.
Yes.
And your mother is still alive, Pearl Stoller.
She's still alive. I just had a talk to her and obligatorily these calls. I wish my mother knew how to do the internet or texting. That way you just show you're making attempts. I always say if my sister and I, we would have been closer years ago if there was texting around because, you know, now you could just say, hey.
Is she your older sister?
Yes, my older and my only sister.
And your mother, does she have a sense of humor?
She's funny, but she has no clue she's being funny. I mean, she's ridiculous. It always bothers me that people think she's charming and sweet because it's how Mr. Ed would only talk to Wilbur. Remember that? It looks like I'm exaggerating. I go, you have her as your mother because they go, hi, yes, I'm proud of Freddie. She puts that act on. She's proud. But I always need evidence from my friend Joel in Brooklyn who'd see the real stuff. So I always need validation of why I'm so messed up. And when you meet her, it doesn't explain it as good as I need it to be explained. But you hit it on the head when you said, you're from Brooklyn, your parents' names are Pearl and Morris. That's all we need.
It's all we need to know. What did your mother tell you growing up about you?
Well, God, she instilled, well, recent, not, yeah, like a year or so, she said to me that when she went to school, it was a nightmare, and that when I went to school, she was reliving the nightmare of school through me. So she instilled in me that growing up was a nightmare, and it was. And from what I understand, I know you have two grown kids, but what I understand is you have kids to redo your childhood, relive it through their eyes, not scream, you'll come home in a box, it's almost over, anytime the kid walks out. She was reliving her horrors through me, and for some reason she deemed my older sister would be okay, and she really said that. Then when I was born, she goes, what's the chance you could have two kids and not have something wrong with one of them? There has to be something wrong. The odds are. So she just anointed that there was something mentally wrong with me. And when I was a kid, I asked her, why does Cindy have a middle name and I don't? And she explained that when my mother was a girl, she got left back in first grade because her mother, I don't know, idolized some sister and never had her in school. And she could never catch up. So my mother, she felt guilty because her mother, who I never met, did everything. Said, you don't know how to do things, and hugged my older sister, fed her, changed her.
So she infantilized your mother.
Yes, she did. So my mother doesn't know how to be a mother. Then her mother died of cancer. And when I said, why don't I have a middle name? She goes, well, your sister, she felt guilty, my mother, for having sexual relations, as she described it. And this is telling to a seven-year-old. After her mother died, a few months after, and I reminded her of that she shouldn't have done, and she felt guilty. And then she said she saw a lot of herself in me, and she didn't like it because she just figured out that I wasn't as social when I was a baby, like Cindy. So she goes, I see myself, you're not social, you're gonna fail, and she'd panic. So,
and you're gonna come home in a box.
Oh, yeah.
Did she literally say you're going to come home in a box?
She did. She did. I mean, these expressions I couldn't make up. She'd go to the devil, you know, when she'd yell at you.
Let's get back to your reminding her of sex. So your grandmother, whose name was?
Frida.
I had a godmother named Frida. Okay. Pearl Moore. I don't know. I think we're from the same neighborhood, Fred.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
okay, hang on for 1 second. So Pearl, your mother Pearl, when Frida, Grandma Frida, when Grandma Frida died.
Right.
Your mother felt guilty for having sex.
Like a few months after Frida died, and I reminded her of that thing she shouldn't have done. How dare you, a few months after your mother died.
So you learned about the birds and the bees when you were seven. She said this to you when you were seven.
Yes, she explained why I don't have a middle name, that she didn't want to have a kid. She was stuck in the suburbs. She can't drive. She didn't know how to be a mother. Oh, another thing, she's been telling me for the last 2 years, she was 5 months pregnant with me, and she didn't know it. She thought she had the flu because she was missing a period. I swear to God.
And she was sick to her stomach.
Yeah, so then a doctor came over, and she explained back then. And you're my age. You probably remember something no one would conceive of, house calls.
Yes.
Doctors, how do we explain this to the young comedy nerds, you know, young guys, that doctors would come to your house with like that bag?
Mm-hmm.
It's unbelievable. Why did they do that, now that I think of it?
So your mother thought...
I thought I hit on a real fascinating topic. Go on.
Okay, so your mother was bloated, missing her period, nauseated.
And the doctor says, you're pregnant. And she goes, no, I have the flu. So she didn't realize she was pregnant until a doctor told her 5 months into it.
And he said, drink plenty of fluids. And she realized had she drunk plenty of fluids five months ago, she wouldn't have been pregnant.
Exactly.
Okay, stop fidgeting with things, Freddie.
It keeps falling out of my ear.
Okay, well, keep it.
This is why my podcast is in a studio.
Okay.
Sure.
I can't be around other people. Your mother told you at the age of seven that she felt guilty for having sex after Grandma Frida died, and that you are a reminder of a sin that she committed, because there should be no pleasure.
Exactly.
After somebody dies.
Right.
And she said that to you.
She said that, and I like Dr. Drew a lot, but I resent him because I just went on his podcast. He goes, she couldn't have said that to you. And I hate when people doubt, you know, because I grew up, and I still don't trust my feelings. If I was sick, you're not sick, school goes on whether you're there or not. If someone was a bully, maybe it's you, you know, so I never trusted my feelings. So I hate when people go, that didn't happen, or you're exaggerating. Except Dr. Drew doesn't sound like my mother when he said that. Right. She couldn't have said that, but she did.
Dr. Drew Pinsky, he's not a real Jew, by the way.
I think, yeah. I
wrote for him like 10 years ago.
I found this out because his wife had a podcast where it's Susan Pinsky, a psychic and a guest, and they called my mother up. Which is pretty funny because the psychic was saying, Freddie will find true love. My mother was arguing, no, he won't. I tell everyone he'd be an awful husband. He has no patience. So hearing my mother argue with a cheery prediction from a psychic, I thought was humorous.
Yeah, Dr. Drew said he's like culturally Jewish, but he wasn't bar mitzvahed and wasn't raised.
Well, Pinsky's the father, so I guess Now, tell me about Jewish history. Why
Hang on for one second.
Why is it the mother that makes you the Jew?
I'll get to that in a second. Pinsky, Drew Pinsky, is married to a psychic?
No, no. His wife, Susan Pinsky, has a podcast where it's a psychic and a guest in her.
And does she disprove psychics? Or
well,
does she believe?
No, she believes in it. And when I was on, it was totally ridiculous. The psychic was going, your father was talkative. He loved to talk, which was not true. And I didn't want to be a jerk and go, yeah, yeah. And they're just throwing out random names. Does Sylvia mean anything? Does Benecki? Then finally they hit on one. And my mother goes, how'd they do that?
So if you stop pouring the water and sit still, what are you doing? We're doing a podcast. What are you doing? Can't you sit still?
I needed some water. It's the summer.
Still. The reason the mother has to be Jewish, why do you think?
Because you just hit it on the head. You're going to fall. You come home in a box. And my mother, my whole life, said, it's almost over. What do I have, 20 years left? In the last 30, it's 10 years left. But Morris, when he got his car, she goes, make sure you like it. It's your last car. But she was right with that. So it's always almost over my whole life.
The reason Jewish mothers determine whether or not the son or the daughter is going to be Jewish and not the father is because, believe it or not, Fred Stoller, Jews have a history of being warriors. Not warriors, warriors. No, warriors, like, you know, conquering other lands. They wouldn't know it from talking to you or me. But going back to the Old Testament, our people were fighters and soldiers. And back then, 4,000 years ago, we raped and pillaged, right?
I guess.
So our soldiers would go in and they'd rape and pillage the Canaanites and the Millerites and the Hittites, and they'd make babies. And then a Hittite woman would come 9 months later into Israel and say, hey, this is your son. And they'd say, no, the mother has to be Jewish. And vice versa, when the Israelis were raided, they got raped, and the women got raped. So the rabbis decided, no matter who the father is, it doesn't matter what the religion is, if the mother is Jewish and she was raped by a Canaanite or a Hittite, maybe not a stalactite, everybody hated the stalactites, but that they would say the child is automatic. We'll accept the child. He's automatically Jewish. It's because soldiers rape. That's why the mothers have to be. If the mother's Jewish, the child is Jewish.
Makes perfect sense.
So your mother said to you at the age of 7, that's how sex was explained to you?
Sexual relations. I guess, how did I process that? Yeah. But I remember crying because sort of saying you weren't wanted, you're a reminder of not being wanted. And
was that the first discussion of the birds and the bees?
I, in my interpretation, what am I trying to say? I didn't think of this as a discussion about the birds and the bees. I just thought of,
When a woman says to you, let's have sex, you say, who died?
When they do say that, which they always, God, have they been saying that lately? when they say that,
that has to be the ear thing, Philip.
Okay, we're good.
You're good? Are you sitting still? And Morris, did Morris say, your father, did he say that the sex, that you reminded him of some great sex, or was he supportive?
He didn't really talk at all. I used to think he was great because he said nothing. My mother would freak out, like, they're going to go out, they'll come home in a box, they're going to Coney Island. Say something, Morris, say something. She goes, that's right, I'm the bad one. I'm going, yeah, you are. So I thought he was great because he did nothing. He just, then when I was older, I thought, oh, I guess a father's supposed to take you canoeing and teach you how to be rough, like Rich Scheidner and Man, and you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I thought that's what a father's supposed to do. Hey, let's throw rocks at things. But he did nothing, so I thought he was great. I remember, talk about Seven, when I was five, my father, excuse me, was having an affair with a woman at work, and my mother, which that I knew because my mother would say, why don't you take Lillian? Take Lillian. Your father's going with Lillian. And then I remember I got a Cracker Jacks ring and I gave it to my father right in front of my mother. I said, Dad, give this to Lillian.
Wow. Me and my sister. Have you shared this with Marc Maron?
No. That's a good one for him.
Why are you wasting your story on me? This is Maron material. Your father had an affair with was she Jewish?
I knew nothing except the name Lillian, but me and my sister we both didn't know anything about her, but we wanted to be taken to Lillian. We wanted Lillian as our nurturing mother. Anything. We thought we wanted to go to her.
Fred Stoller, this is your next book.
Yeah, yeah.
Why aren't you writing a book about your mother? I mean, it sounds almost as difficult as your Seinfeld year.
Well, first of all, there's a lot of stuff about my mother in my book, and my mother won't read it. She can't. And it's not as damning as this. It's just lighthearted. Well, it's a stuff about you'll come home in a box. And this sounds like a joke, but it's true. I want to get a job at Burger King, my own spending money. She goes, yeah, they're waiting for you. And she really said that because she thought I was going to fail. I think I said she was reliving the nightmare of growing up through me, she said. So she thought I'd get rejected at Burger King. So
they're waiting for you.
Yeah. So
which also happens to have been the Burger King slogan in the 60s.
So basically, she can't read my book. Some people told her this stuff about in it. She can't look at people who've read the book. I was in Florida, where she lives, and I tried. David, there's been lots of ripoffs in show business. The biggest ripoff was Publicists. They're just ridiculous. I said, I need a book signing in Florida, visiting my mother. And it was this feeble Spanish-speaking mall, and I'd sit there with my mother with a little chair and like selling vitamins, waving people in. And then her friend was going to read the book, buy it, and my mother stopped her saying, it's too expensive. Then she confessed to me, I don't want her to have the book. She'll know the truth about me and you. She'll think less of me.
Well, were you raised with secrets? I mean, it sounds like you're...
Well, I didn't know about the 3 months pregnant, the 5 months pregnant until Dr. Drew. No, my mother, we knew about Lillian. She just told it to everyone, you know, right in front of the kids. Take Lillian. Your father's with Lillian. And I longed for Lillian.
Did your father admit to Lillian?
I think so. But then it didn't happen. And then he just gave up and stayed with Pearl.
What didn't happen?
Whatever was going to happen with Lillian.
He was going to leave with Lillian?
I don't know those details. It just kind of went away.
But it wasn't traumatic? I would think the idea of your father...
It was traumatic that my father... I used to root for them to get divorced. I used to feel sorry for him and want him away from her. So we used to protect my father like a scared little kitten. And so it was traumatic that... I never got to be nurtured by Lillian, just assuming she was nurturing what I wanted.
Was there any joy?
And all the people out there, they're going to go, I want to listen to this podcast. It sounds hysterical. A lot of laughs.
The Mild Adventures of Fred Stoller, available for download on Stitcher and iTunes. Was there any joy? Did your father ever come to your defense?
Yes. I talked about my book the time he... I think he was shell-shocked in Anzio. I'm learning about World War II after he passed away. And
your father fought at Anzio.
Yes, and this guy, you should get this guy on, Steve Karras. He's fanatic World War II historian and sent me discharge papers, how my father was injured, where he was injured, Anzio, all the places he fought.
So your father was with Patton's army?
I think Audie Murphy to 3rd Battalion, I think, something like that. Yeah, front line.
Okay, and machine gunners. Anzio, Italy, that's where Bob Dole was injured.
It was, from what I'm learning, obviously it didn't have the publicity of D-Day, but it was just as harried and just as death trap. Again, I'm new at learning about World War II history, but it was some botched thing to chokehold the Germans. I don't know, but it was a bloodbath. And
what happened to your father?
Okay, more comedy. You mean literally at Anzio or just in general?
What happened at Anzio?
The story, it's funny. He told my mother, and it's not funny, but he goes, I'm only telling you once, but I'd hear this from my uncle, that father was on a boat, and the sergeant said, switch places, and it hit a mine, and I guess survivor's guilt. Ooh, survivor's guilt with him and my mother.
He not switched places, he would
have... Oh, he said, we heard that his buddy's heads were floating in the water once he went to basic training, and my father was a skinny, not that skinny matters, sensitive, artistic guy, and then, you know, I once said, Dad, did you ever kill anyone? He goes, I don't want to talk about it, but I can't imagine. So then he swam to shore. He sees all these Nazis coming towards him, going, okay, I'm captured. Turned out there were hundreds more Americans behind the Nazis. So the Nazis, he thought, were coming to get him, were prisoners of war, some Americans behind them. He had a breakdown, went to some hospital, and he just was a very quiet guy.
Had a breakdown during World War II.
I guess after that incident at Anzio.
Yeah, they don't talk about the PTSD from World War II.
No, because I think it was a good war. I mean, that's another topic, David, but I wonder, have we gotten any better with Iraq? And these, I think the suicides are still off the charts, even though people know the term post-traumatic stressism, and there's medication and support groups. It just doesn't sound like something that we're getting better at helping people with. But back then, that was the good war, World War II, and no one knew it was such a thing, or, you know.
So, not to defend Pearl and Morris.
Sure.
But when you consider the avalanche of bad news that came their way.
Yes.
Can you understand why your mother would be so negative? I mean, was there anything positive that happened in this woman's life?
Yes. And this I talk about in my book. Whenever a monkey came on TV, she'd laugh, go, Freddie, look at the monkey. Freddie likes the monkey. So she'd laugh when monkeys came on the TV. But I think she was displacing that on me, going, Freddie's laughing at a monkey. I think she liked monkeys.
But she wasn't laughing. She would say,
Yeah, I think she was enjoying it, but she made it like she was doing something for me, going, look at the monkey.
And she grew up during the Great Depression.
Yeah. Well, yeah, born in 26.
And Grandma Frieda was from where?
I think Austria.
That's a fancy Jew.
Yeah, my father's parents were Russian Jews.
Not so fancy.
No.
But Austrian Jews were fancy.
Well, I don't know if she was fancy.
But they came from poverty, right?
Yep.
They all came from poverty, and your father, his parents came from pogroms. They'd wait around.
Well, I told you, the time he took my, he stood up for me was, we saw this movie, Charlie.
Well, hang on for one second. So your grandfather came from Russia, where they were being raped and pillaged. He comes.
I didn't know that at the time, but now I guess.
So that's,
that happened.
That's your father's family of origin. Then he comes to America, and he's living in a tenement, and there's the Great Depression, and there's no war, no work until there's a war, and he goes off, and he sees his friend's head floating in the water.
All his friends, yeah.
So, you know, you come back from World War II, what's to be happy about?
Yeah, that's a good point.
I mean, there are people who rise above that and find joy.
My father did have joy. Actually, I have to
Lillian.
Say that too. I have to say his retirement was inspiring because he all his life he didn't want to live in Sheepshead Bay in Brooklyn, but my mother wouldn't have it because she goes, I don't know how to drive. I don't want to live in the suburbs. He wanted to have a basement with a train set, but she wouldn't let that. So then, and she wouldn't even let him retire. You know, no, we need the money. What happens? Finally, he retires in Florida. And he found happiness at the end because he was artistic. And he took the painting class, sculpture class. And it was so refreshing because I remember he bought a digital camera. And to learn, and you know, being here in L.A., everyone who does something artistic has an agenda. I'm going to do a sizzle reel. This will a short film festival. This will be on Adult Swim. You know, he just was creative without the agenda of what this may lead to. You know, oh, I'm not going to do a podcast. So
right.
He was inspiring that he in retirement, he didn't just sit there depressed looking at the TV. He was creative.
Yeah.
So he had joy at the end.
You know, Jeb Bush, who should rot in hell, said that immigrants coming to America, it's an act of love. And I agree with him. He wouldn't know anything about the immigrant experience, although maybe he would because he's married to Columba. But it is an act of love when you come to America, whether you're undocumented or not. Every time I see the face of a newly arrived undocumented worker, I see the faces of my four grandparents who were traumatized from the land that they were escaping and are being traumatized in America. It is a trauma to come to America. You're not doing it.
It was traumatizing doing your podcast when I'd have to wait in the hall with people playing the guitar.
What I'm saying is the things that Donald Trump says, the things that the Republicans say about undocumented workers is so un-American and so criminal and so godless because every immigrant who comes to America, for the most part, unless they're brought in by Facebook, or, you know, unless they, you know, unless they're tech people, but people who crawl through the gutters to get here, are leaving a trauma for a new trauma because America does not welcome undocumented workers with open arms. My four grandparents weren't patted on the head and said it's going to be great here, but they come here because they want their children to do better.
Right.
But it's pretty rough. It's pretty rough.
Both my
grandfathers were said, you know, they came to America and they said, welcome to America. Now you're going back to Europe. Here's a gun. Go fight. You know, so to pick on undocumented workers is just so sinful. And it's not even a problem for most of America. 40% of all undocumented workers are in California. And I was very proud. They did a poll of Californians, and a vast majority of Californians who are citizens say that undocumented workers are a net plus for the state of California. And that's why Governor Jerry Brown now is giving undocumented workers driver's licenses so that they can earn a living. When it's an abstraction, when you're not really dealing with undocumented workers, it's easy and fun to blame them.
Right.
But in California, where you're up close and see the humanity, you have nothing but compassion for the undocumented workers. And the same thing goes for Texas. That's why George W. Bush and Rick Perry, as stupid as he is, they are very sympathetic to the plight of undocumented workers, and they recognize the value of undocumented workers. It's the people in the Midwest, the people like Donald Trump in New York, where undocumented workers are more of an abstraction. They're guys that Trump hires when he needs them, and they're easy picking to use as scapegoats. And it's really, as the grandson of four immigrants, and I suspect they were at one time undocumented, if you got here, if you somehow got into this country, you should be welcomed with open arms. And that being said, I'm going to miss Trump. He is fun to watch, isn't he?
He's like, some say, like a super villain in some movie, you know, crazy. Yeah. It's like Ted Nugent, just someone just talking to shock people.
I don't know. But, you know, Trump, he's just fun to watch. As long as he's such a caricature,
such a cartoon. Yeah. Like seeing him at the debates, he doesn't even look like a politician. He's just like Mr. T or something. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just some cartoon like Cato Kaelin or something. Like not quite.
Has your mother ever said she was proud of you? Did she ever see?
Yes. Well, it's weird, and I'm not. I sound like I'm this guy bashing my mother. She was only proud of me, until she moved to Florida, because then, people said, "Oh, I've seen him on The Nanny." So when other people validated me, Freddie, people knew who you were. Why? How'd that happen? So yes, because I've gotten some approvals and recognitions, like at Costco when she's buying her phone cards. She still thinks, you know, she doesn't understand about unlimited long distance or Skype. Of course, she doesn't know Skype. So we go to Costco and I visit so she can make long distance calls.
So where was the first place you did stand up?
Well, the thing is, excuse me, I got turned on to stand up when I was 17. I went with my older sister and we saw Richard Lewis and Billy Crystal at Pips Comedy Club in Brooklyn. And this is before they even made it big. And this is even before Richard Lewis was doing his more pronounced neurotic. He was sort of just doing regular observations. And I was pathologically shy and depressed. No one in the world said I was funny. I wasn't. But I remember one of my sister's friends saying, there's a club called The Improv. That's where Jimmy Walker, Freddie Prinze did their act, and they got on The Tonight Show, and then they get to be on a sitcom. So I always wanted to be a character actor, but I had no idea how you did it. It's not like now where you go on YouTube or you watch things, you're more savvy. I just thought, all right, you become a comedian, then you get on a sitcom. So I just told myself, even though I'm pathologically shy, I only needed to do it one time because I pictured Johnny Carson going, this is a, no, I pictured me on Johnny Carson going, this is only my second time doing stand-up. Mm-hmm. So I really didn't know about scoping out little rooms. Again, like I said, it's not the internet where you know the scene. I just knew the improv. So my first time I auditioned Sunday nights, Judy Orbach, that name may not mean a lot to a lot of people. Now I think she manages actors, but she was the gatekeeper. She ran Sunday nights. Some people there were like Glenn Hirsch. You may know him, Jimmy Brogan, Robert Wall, Barry Diamond. So I remember I did my research. And again, I'm being repetitious. It's not like now you go on YouTube, you see Saturday Night Live sketches. I just listened to some comedy albums, and from who I heard, Jimmy Walker, Richard Pryor, Freddie Prinze, they all came from bad neighborhoods.
Oh, you're boring me.
Okay.
I'm bored.
I'm sorry. Okay, well, that was my chronology.
Well, I wasn't, yeah, I know, but I don't need the story to last as long as your lifetime of stand-up.
Okay.
But
the improv was the first place.
I remember seeing you in the early 80s being very drunk and walking up to you at the bar at Kvetch.
I was drunk or you were drunk?
I was drunk. And you were talking to...
Gilbert Gottfried?
No, you were talking to somebody who managed... not Engelbert Humperdinck, but some... I can't remember, some manager, and I was drunk and fawning over you, and you had you were telling like elephant jokes, right?
What?
You used to like jokes about elephants and trees.
No, I used to do this joke. Why did the monkey fall out of the tree? Because he was dead. Then a few jokes later, I'd go, why did the second monkey fall out of the tree? He was dead. Then a few minutes more, why the third? And then peer pressure was the joke.
I remember being drunk and stoned and thinking you were absolutely hysterical and walking up to you drunk and just making a fool out of myself.
Wow.
And thinking that there's nothing else Fred Stoller could ever do but stand-up comedy.
Well, that didn't quite happen. I stopped for 17 years. And back in those early 80 days, you could just do weird non sequitur one-liners. But then I had to make a living, go on the road, and you go, hey, here we are in Chicago, and cater to them and follow some local guy doing theme songs. And I guess my act had to be watered down where I was more accessible, not such a weirdo, but I kind of grew up and stopped being this weirdo who couldn't look at the crowd. So a lot of those weird kind of early jokes you saw stopped working. I had to be more conversational.
I saw my mother and sister yesterday. I went out to Jersey, and they kept saying to me, what is everybody laughing at? What are they laughing at?
Well, wait. When you did your act, they were saying
that? No. When they say, you know, I turn on the TV and I watch the stand-ups and I don't, what is the audience laughing at? They're not saying anything funny.
My mother used, when my father was alive, she listened to talk radio, a clock radio between her and my father. And she goes, Gilbert was on some show. He woke him up. He was screaming. Why was he screaming?
But I had to explain to my mother and sister that, you know, sometimes people say things in a funny manner that you don't, that they don't have to tell jokes, that sometimes people just say things in a weird way and the audience laughs at that. But I was raised to say funny things.
Oh, yeah. No, there was nothing too funny. My mother says things unintentionally funny. I think I told you, sadly, she was mugged back in 2008, and a black guy grabbed the purse. She fell down. She goes, it's not going to stop me. I'm still going to vote for Obama. So even though a black guy did something not nice, she's open enough to realize it wasn't Obama. And if Obama did get elected, he probably wouldn't throw her down on the floor grabbing a purse.
Were you raised in a liberal household? Were politics important?
Well, yes and no. That my mother has compassion for minorities. And my mother would listen to like these talk radio. Remember a guy, Bob Grant?
We were just talking about him the other day. Yes.
And she would listen and get mad. You know, yeah, talk about before his time, the Puerto Ricans, send them back. The ear thing fell out. All these things. So she was sympathetic, like I said, to minorities. Well, you know, I grew up in a Jewish neighborhood, believe it or not, but the Jews would hate our family because we weren't observant Jews. They were very racist and small-minded in Sheepshead Bay, Brooklyn. But twice a year, they would dress up the Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, and my friend's father would say, Freddie, I'm going to wish you a happy new year, even though you're practicing to be a goyim. And they try to guilt us. Or in Passover, you can't play with Freddie, he eats kumets. We were bad Jews. My father said something funny. The house burnt. We had a fire, an electric fire. Then the rabbi goes, this is what you should get. This is, you should now start going to temple and be thankful you weren't, you know, killed. And my father goes, no, everyone else on the block should go to temple, pray, be glad their house didn't burn down.
That's what he said to the rabbi.
Yeah.
He stood up to the rabbi.
Yeah, they were kind of bullies. And I just saw they were very racist. You know what I didn't like about, you see, I didn't know, David, that Jews were a minority. I went to a Jewish camp. There would always be these menorahs in the windows. I didn't know we were a minority. And what I didn't like about the Jews was every word was us against them. The goyim, the schwitzes, the schwarzes, the shekes. It's like, I didn't like this us against them thing. But I guess it comes from a real place. I guess there's a reason why, you know, the obvious persecution. So you got to come up with names so everyone else is the enemy and a bad name.
Well, if you're getting beaten all the time, it does something to you.
Yeah.
I didn't hear racism growing up, but I knew of Jewish racism. But when push came to shove, they supported the civil rights movement.
I don't understand what happened where the Jews really supported the civil rights and why. What's going on lately? My mother doesn't like Trump or people like Bush. She says they're bullies, and a lot of Jews in Florida. I don't know if it's just Florida or for Republicans that they have this thing in their head that Democrats are not for Israel. What is that about?
They're easily frightened.
Right.
So anyway, Fred Stoller has a brand new show called The Mild Adventures of Fred Stoller. Everybody should download it on iTunes. He has two books, My Seinfeld Year. It's a Kindle single, a best-selling Kindle single, and I do mean a bestseller. And Maybe We'll Have You Back, which comes out in paperback in September. You should write a book about your mother.
People were telling me about...
Here's the title.
Right.
Surviving Pearl.
That's not bad. People were telling me, why couldn't you wait till she died, till you wrote the book? Because there's stuff in it. And you made a good point. I can't wait till she dies. Oh, that's a morbid joke, but it's crazy. Right. I remember you used to live around here, the Park La Brea Vet. And back, the love of my life, Mitchell, my cat, I remember when he had a kidney problem. And I'm trying to get reassurance from the vet. And I said, my friend said, my parents will probably go before my cat. I hope so. The vet looked at me. What are you nuts? Because I was trying to get reassurance that Mitchell will outlive my parents.
How long has Mitchell been gone?
He's been gone about a year and a half.
And are you going to... he lived a long... He made it to
18 years. I still have Buddy, who's 19. A little over 19. So I thought Mitchell needed a buddy. And she's sweet. And Mitchell... was an amazing. When I got, speaking of Pearl, she goes, why'd you get a cat and not a girlfriend? What, you know, like I had the choice. Like I go to a store.
Could you have brought a woman home to Pearl, and would Pearl have approved of her?
It's a good question. She met this girl, Rena. She didn't like her. I don't think so. No, I dated, I don't want to say, like, whatever. Back in 1980, Stiller and Mirror's daughter, Amy Stiller, who you might know, and she was very proud of, even though it was a crazy situation, to say the least, you know, and Mirror, no, I'm just kidding, if you know Amy Stiller, but we were written up in the Cape Cod News, and my mother, I go, what do you have that for? Just, Amy's mean, and maybe I'm proud of you. Proud that was dating someone famous's daughter. So it's a lot of pathology, but there's a lot of laughs with the podcast.
So Mitchell's been gone for a year and a half. Buddy is how old? 19?
She's 19. She has a hyperthyroid, so she howls a lot, but she thinks she has a headache, the blood rushes.
Hey, why was Mitchell the love of your life?
Because I never was as close to anything as that cat. Listen to my parents, girlfriends, then no one stuck with me like Mitchell, even though if I opened the door, I tried to run out. But
did you have him as a kid?
Yep, 11 weeks. An amazing, amazing, right from the start. Like, I didn't grow up with cats. I didn't get cats till I got an amazing cat and love them all, even quote-unquote bad ones.
And was Mitchell smart or just affectionate?
I think he was, that's a good question, because I had an iPad with the app where it's mice and he kept batting it. So I guess he didn't know it was an iPad, but he'd jump into my arms to be held, and just an amazing personality. Anyone came in, he'd be rubbing them on their shoes, their bag, poking me for treats. Like I said, leaping into my arms to be held. So I don't know how smart he was, because, you know, you did a flashlight thing, and he thought it was something to chase. So I guess I should, you know, like I dated a crazy cat lady, and she would spell cat in front of Thatch, because I know Swati's F-A-T. is this off topic? Could I tell you that one of the craziest cat stories, if you're a cynic with psychics? Now, someone we both know, I won't say her name, but nice lady. She had kittens, and they were, I guess, litter mates, and one of them died of some heart thing, sadly, at, let's say, 3 or something. So she takes the surviving cat to a cat psychic so the cat psychic could tell the surviving one that her little mate is doing okay in the beyond. So first you have to buy, number one, the psychic communicates with dead cats. Number two, that the surviving cat understands that and understands that the psychic is saying, Ripa B wants you to be happy. It's another story that'll be edited out. Okay, I lost.
Well, and what was that? What was that? Was that a car driving away from that story? Sounds like a Prius saying,
well, it's Tom Kenny. He drives by and him and his wife laugh. They stick their head out the window because I live in an apartment, not a house like them. So he laughs. He taunts me, you know.
The only person in the world
has had trouble with Tom Kenny.
Who has had trouble with
Tom Kenny? Well, his last SpongeBob contract, he demanded a Brinks truck back up to his house so his neighbor could see it. And I said, Tom, why does it have to back up? That's the expression. They backed up the Brinks truck. Went, all right, I guess. But then he had the Brinks truck do it again because no neighbors were watching.
Don't you do that with Pearl? You call her up and tell her horror stories about Tom Kenny?
I do. And she goes, how's that guy doing? He thinks he's better than everyone. That at the Grove, him and his wife, Jill, they stand by the ATM machine and laugh at it because they have more money than it.
He's the kindest man in the world, and you're inventing horror stories about Tom Kenny that are simply not true.
Well, just for Pearl.
Okay. Freddie, you'll come back again?
I will if this came out, and hopefully you can be on my podcast. I took your format. I don't do one. Well, this is one-on-one, but I'm lucky that I'm in a studio with this 5 mics, so I just try to fill it up with people in that way. You know, if someone is losing attention, someone else could take over.
Mm-hmm. Well, good. You know. All right, buddy. Thank you. Fred Stoller.
Thank you.